Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we shall be discussing different types of bioreactors. You know, bioreactor is a device that provides this kind of environment that supports the microorganisms, and a number of microorganism related reactions are carried out in the bioreactors. Bioreactor is a very, very important component in industry as well as in those laboratories which are working in the field of microbiology, environment, biochemistry, etc. So, the learning objectives of this module are to study control growth conditions of microbes, to understand the applications of bioreactors in environment or in environmental sciences, to study various type of bioreactors with their advantages and limitations, and to study the strategies for selection of a bioreactor. Basically, bioreactors are vessels that are used to perform biochemical reactions by using microorganisms, plant cells and animal cells for the production of different biological products. These bioreactors basically provide controlled environment for optimal growth of biological systems for the production of desired products. For example, fermenters are used in fermentation industries. In the fermenters, low value substrate is consumed by microbial cells or enzymes to produce high value products. As far as fermenters are concerned, they are widely used in food processing, fermentation industry, waste treatment processes, etc. The term fermenter is basically used as a synonym to bioreactors. The first pilot scale fermenter was established in India at Hindustan Antibiotics Limited, Pune, in the year 1950s. This figure shows the applications of bioreactors. Bioreactors have very wide applications in a number of fields, and they may have application in pharmaceuticals, biofuel and bioenergy, management of environmental pollution, nutraceuticals and probiotics manufacturing, then in agriculture, in food and beverages industries. So, this list shows that there are wide applications of bioreactors. Bioreactors are different from chemical reactors, where the more support and control required for the growth of biological systems. Bioreactors provide more sophistication due to sensitivity from foreign microbes, because otherwise if there is no sophistication, that may lead to contamination. Regular agitation and aeration is expected within a bioreactor so as to ensure sufficient heat and mass transfer. Bioreactors are highly selective to produce the desired products. Selectivity is much more important in the production of antibiotics, steroids, vitamins, proteins, certain sugars and organic acids. In a bioreactor, rate of reaction is critical as in the biological reactions. A proper incubation time is required to assist the growth of microbes to achieve the desired product formation. This incubation period may depend on the reaction type, product type, and type of organisms used in the bioreactor. Besides that, consider the reaction parameters like temperature, pH, substrate concentration, moisture content, salt concentration, vitamins, oxygen is important for aerobic processes. Then gases generated in the bioreactors and products and byproducts removal prior to design of a bioreactor. Means we have to study, we must have the knowledge of number of parameters before designing a bioreactor, as we have discussed just now. Reactor type varies with the mode of operation and the product generated. Bioreactor types. Bioreactor can be classified in a number of ways. Based upon the type of cultures used, bioreactors are of several types, such as bioreactors used in microbial cell culture, bioreactors used in animal cell culture, bioreactors used in algal cell culture, bioreactors used in microbial cell culture. Microorganisms are used in industry for production of commercially important products, can be divided on the basis of oxygen demand of the microbial cell and the need for stirring. Based on these are also classified into a number of classes, and these classes are aerobic reactors, mechanically driven. The example of mechanically driven bioreactors are stirred tank reactors called as STR reactors, air driven bioreactors, example is airlift reactor, that is ALR, and bubble column reactors, BCR. So there may be classifications on the basis of culture used and on the basis of oxygen demand. Let me discuss some of these reactors one by one. First of all, let me take aerobic reactors, and among aerobic reactors, let me discuss stirred tank bioreactor. Stirred tank bioreactor is a conventional glass, maybe of borosilicate, or stainless steel reactor with the provision of mixing. The stirrer is either incorporated on upward or downward of the reactor vessel, and that is shown in the figure, that is shown in the next slide. As shown in this figure, the sterile medium and the inoculum are fed into the sterilized tank, and air is supplied from the downward. To ensure proper mixing, additional impeller and baffles are also provided within the vessel. This all aid to overcome a whirl effect that could hindrance proper mixing. The number of baffles generally varies within 4 to 8 depending on the diameter of the vessel. During this process, the bubbles generated to air supply are broken down by the agitator system as they move upward. Most widely used impellers are the 4-blade disc turbine called as Ruston type, and the exhaust gas generated during the course of reactor is removed from the top of the tank through gas exhaust pipe while the product come down. What are the advantages of this type of reactors? This type of reactors require less capital and less operation cost. Due to high stirring, mass and heat transfer limitations are overcome. These reactors have some limitations also. The major limitations are foaming is the major drawback associated with stirred tank reactors. So, anti-foaming agents should be incorporated in the reaction mixtures to tackle or to handle the problem of foam formation. Yet, this has to be practiced cautiously, as certain anti-foaming agents, they inhibit microbial growth. Sometimes this foaming may lead to contamination of the reactor also, and that may affect the overall performance of the reactor. This figure shows the diagram of internal diagram and different parts of the stirred tank reactor. Second type of aerobic reactors are airlift reactors and bubble column reactors. This type of reactors are also called as tower reactors or bubble column with a draft tube. Air is generally flown into the bottom of a central draught tube through a ring type sparger that regulates the air and medium circulation. ALR are used when process need more oxygen transfer rate and less power consumption. Air flows as tiny bubbles carrying the medium upward toward the head space of the reactor. along the draft tube, and excess gas or exhaust gases generated are sapped out of the reaction medium at the top of the column. The degassed broth along with the product gradually passes down through downcomer and is collected from the bottom of the tank. The draft tube can be used as internal heat exchanger, axial mixing throughout the whole reactor, reduction of bubble coalescence and equalizes shear force. ALR has three configurations. First one is divide vessel with draft tube. Second is draft tube internal loop reactor, and third is external loop reactor. ALR are having four components like riser, gas liquid separator, downcomer and bottom. Now, what are the advantages of bubble column reactor? Bubble column reactors are absolutely sterile operation, less internal parts, easy cleaning and no sealing problem. Where these reactors can be applied? This type of reactors can be used in wastewater treatment, production of baker's yeast, beer, etc. ALR are used in tissue culture also. This figure shows the diagram of ALR bioreactors. What are the advantages? Simple reactor devoid of additional mixing parts or agitator system, and thus less maintenance cost and reduce shear stress. This system is suitable for both plant and animal cells due to low shear rate. It enables homogeneous gas distribution obligatory for aerobic processes, low energy input due to lack of agitation, high degree of heat and mass transfer due to oxygen circulation, enhanced area by volume inside the tank due to absence of mixing shaft. Let me come to the limitations of these reactors. Additional investment for air supply, especially significant in case of large scale processes, high air throughput and pressure is needed for uniform circulation, difficult to maintain constant concentration of the substrate, nutrients, oxygen and organisms within the reactor at a given time. In this reactor system, foaming impedes proper gas or liquid separation. Nevertheless, these limitations can be overruled by appropriate designing of airlift systems. For instance, instead of single feeding point, multiple feeding provisions must be made to ensure the organisms experience continuous cycles of high growth throughout the vessel, resulting in desirable products, higher yields and lower mortality rates. The same applies for entry point of oxygen. Therefore, it must be delivered at different places within the reactor, with the main stream entering from the bottom of the vessel. Now, let we have a look on the anaerobic reactors. As the name indicating, anaerobic reactors operate in the complete absence of aeration, air or oxygen. These reactors are conventionally employed in the production of ethanol, wine, beer, as well as in wastewater treatment. Various byproduct gases are involved from the reaction mixture upon fermentation. Ensure proper mixing, thereby ruling out necessity for mixing apparatus. Let me discuss different types of anaerobic bioreactors. First one is upflow anaerobic sludge blanket bioreactor. This UASB was given by Professor Lettinga, working at this Technical University of Delft. UASB bioreactor, upflow anaerobic sludge blanket reactor, is a type of anaerobic reactor which contains a blanket of granular sludge suspended within the reactor. Biomass growth occurs on the fine sludge particles, which then form sludge granules having high specific gravity. A stream of feed is pumped upward through a mechanical pump so that the contact between the feed and the granular sludge is ideal. The movement of feed in the upward direction and the pull of gravity upon the sludge bed is downward direction, aid in proper suspension of the blanket. This reactor is widely used for the wastewater treatment. Packed bed reactor is another type of anaerobic bioreactors. PBR consists of a hollow tube in which packing material is filled in order to improve the contact between the different phases involved in the reaction mixture. There are generally two types of packings. One is random packing with the objects like Rayleigh rings, and other is organized packing with structured packing material. Diagrammatic representation of this packed bed reactor is shown in this figure. Packed bed reactors have successfully been used in solid state fermentation. Nowadays, solid state fermentation is widely used to produce a number of products. Microbial culture generally functions in two different forms. One is submerged and other is immobilized form. Immobilized forms of microbial cultures are advantageous over the submerged forms in terms of reduced toxicity caused by inhibitory products, reuse, and minimal or no washout of cells. Another type of reactors are moving bed or fluidized bed reactors, called as FBR also. Fluidized bed reactor is a type of reactor in which a variety of multiphase biochemical reactions can be performed. Generally, a fluid, that fluid may be a gas or a liquid, is pumped upwards through a granular sludge bed at high velocity so as to suspend the sludge properly within the reactor. This process of suspending the sludge granules by maintaining a high pressure of fluid upward is known as fluidization. In this kind of reactors, heat and mass transfer coefficients are very high between particle gas and bed surface. These reactors are mostly used for solid state fermentation because of the following reasons. The reasons are removal of the heat produced during the reaction by the gas phase involved in fluidization, healthy growth of microbes due to efficient aeration by the fluidizing air, instantaneous removal of metabolic products which might inhibit the fermentation process, no temperature gradient due to proper mixing of the substrate, high productivity in comparison to traditional solid state fermentation. Scale up is relatively easy as many parallel fibers can be incorporated. Simultaneous extraction of extracellular products from the reaction mixture is possible. High productivity can be expected. FBRs also have certain limitations. Let we have look on different limitations of FBRs. In FBRs, clogging of pores possesses problem. High cell growth may deform and rupture the hollow fibers. Accumulation of any toxic byproducts within the fiber may inhibit the microbial growth. Most of the time, FBR is used for encourage dependent, that is micro carriers, animal cell cultures, and successfully explored in CSTR. However, upon increasing the cell density, the problems of improper mixing arises, and hence alternative means of providing efficient mass transfer of oxygen and nutrients is required, that can be solved by fluidized bed reactors. Since the content in this scheme are always in a fluidized state. Advantages of fluidized bed reactors for animal cell cultures are both anchorage dependent and independent cells can be cultured. High cell densities can be obtained. Efficient mass and heat transfer can be achieved and less energy requirements. Another type of reactors are those reactors that are called as photobioreactors. Photobioreactors are used for algal cultures. Photobioreactors are basically designed for wastewater treatment, water quality management, and algal culture. Photoautotrophs, photoheterotrophs, blue-green algae are used in photobioreactors. Photobioreactor is a system that regulates its environment as per the need of the specific algae grown in a particular photobioreactor. Various factors that affect these photobioreactors are carbon dioxide concentration, light, pH, and temperature. Photobioreactors are mostly categorized on the basis to increase surface area of vessel for enhanced aeration that could be used for the growth of microorganisms. This figure shows the line diagram of a photobioreactor. Dear students, photobioreactors are widely used in a number of industries, particularly in China, to capture the carbon dioxide that is present in the industrial exhaust. So, what the people are doing in China, they are making a number of photobioreactors along with the stacks or chimney of their industry. The carbon dioxide from that chimney is used in the photobioreactors, and the algae so over there produced is used in a number of other applications. So, dear student, please study about these photobioreactors and find out that how the carbon dioxide is managed by them, and secondly, how this algae can be converted into highly valuable products. Let me study the applications of bioreactors in environmental problem solving. Bioconversion of waste to wealth or value added products has potential role in environmental pollution control and simultaneously in resource utilization. As one example of bioreactors I have given you, here on the one side one pollutant is controlled and on the other side we are getting a product. Bioreactors required for waste management don't require stringent aseptic conditions. The mixed microbial and aquatic system stabilize the waste. Gaseous effluents can be managed by biofilters and bioscrubbers also. Please study about biofilters and bioscrubber in detail. In biofilters, pollutants are removed through sorption and oxidized by the microorganisms immobilized in the bed. When biofilters failed due to heavier pollutant loading, activated sludge mixed and further contacted with gas effluent in packed bed reactor. This table gives a comparison of different type of bioreactors. Here we have taken stirred tank reactors, airlift reactors, bubble column reactors, and photoreactors. Let me see them one by one. Stirred tank reactors. In stirred tank reactors, flow phenomena is difficult to predict, that is influenced by agitation and aeration. In airlift reactors, riser of airlift reactor resembles the bubble column, but gas holdup is less than the predicted equation used in bubble column. Bubble column reactor, coalescing liquid is for non-viscous fluid, bubbles take the equilibrium size, non-coalescing liquid is for small size bubble. In photobioreactor, glass or plastic tube that are horizontally or vertically for the growth of light dependent organisms or microbes. When we select a bioreactor for our study, we have to take several factors into our consideration. These factors include the type of microorganisms, oxygen requirement, sterilization method to be used, requirement of light is there or not, and the material of the construction of the bioreactor. So, to summarize this module, in this module we have studied or we have learnt that what is a bioreactor, what are different type of bioreactors. Bioreactors can be classified on the basis of culture and on the basis of oxygen reactor. Then we have studied different type of bioreactors, and in the end we have studied about photobioreactors. We have also studied in this module the advantages, disadvantages and applications of each type of bioreactors. Thank you.